What is a mean value theorem? Because we had a mean value theorem before, didn't we? It looked like this. F prime of C is equal to F of B minus F of A over B minus A. There is a C such that, and if it's continuous differentiable, blah, blah, blah. That was a mean value theorem, right? And then they give you another mean value theorem. And like, why would you want to say, like, right? And what does it mean? What does it even look like? So let me give you an idea, the picture. So suppose there is a function. Okay, and then my function always look like this. This is my f. Okay, and suppose there's a a and b that we integrate this over. So I'm gonna draw it like that. Make it black. Draw it right here, like that. Okay, so this is my point A, and this is my point B. So when we say integral from A to B and f of x dx, that is the area under this curve, right? And this ties into mean value theorem. When I say A to B, this is not a function, this is a number. It's just an area, isn't it? That's kind of what you did in the number two on your quiz. It gives you that area, infinitely many, infinitely thin rectangles and add up the area. That's what it is. So it's not a function, although there's a function in it, but it's like plugging some function and get the value kind of thing. But instead of getting the y value, it gives you the area. That's what that thing is, which is a huge concept later because we are going to make a function out of it. Now, but say this is a box of sand, and some of you had a sand farm before when you're young. So this is a sand farm and bunch of sand. Let's say you flatten this sand out, okay? And then that picture now is gonna look like this. Say average is somewhere about here like that. That looks like average to you. I can go a little lower. But then good thing about this is a computer. So make that green and go lower like that. That's about average. So you move that sand up higher, then fill it here. And that's the average, right? So this is the average of the function within this interval a and b. So far, so good. Then we have exact same amount of sand as before. So this gotta be the average value is the idea. Then area of this rectangle and the green line, how do you calculate that? Well, this right here is b minus a, isn't it? Good. So we multiply b minus a times the average value of f, and they have to be the same. You like that idea so far? You with me? Okay, having said that, then what is the average value? What is the average value of f within that interval? Well, it's got to be the area under that curve, which is this, divided by b minus a. How's that? B minus a is just a number. It could be 5, it could be 7, it could be 12. You know what I'm saying? So that is the mean value theorem. Now, the way they put it here make it look more intimidating and scary, but this is a number, this is a number. So the way I would do it is you calculate this area and evaluate the integral, and then averages divide by this number. Right? So it's a number divided by a number. You get it? That didn't work. Hold on. Whoa, that just erases. How about that? Better? So far, so good. So that's a mean value theorem. Then how do you distinguish this mean value theorem from original mean value theorem we had earlier? Okay, and then there's why would they both call it the same thing? They are really the same things. One day I'm going to explain it to you why they are the same thing, but for now I don't want to confuse you. So this is mean value theorem one, this is mean value theorem two. It's really a differential form and integral form. here we are talking about average rate. This is a slope, which is a rate. You know what I'm saying? This is an average rate formula. So this is a keyword. When they talk about average rate in a problem, it's this one. This is average value. This is the value of this thingy. You know what I'm saying? Y value. So that's how you distinguish the two, because they are unfortunately both called the mean value theorem. Good question before I move on.
Yes.
Yeah.
So one gives you for like the red one, the top right, that one gives you the X value and the other one gives you the Y value.
Kind of. Well, this kind one gives right. you X value where it's the average rate.
Yeah.
And this
okay.
one gives you Y, average Y value. How's that?
Okay, yeah, okay, that's my point. Thank you.
Okay. Let's prove the most important theorem in the history. It's called the fundamental theorem of calculus. This is it. This is the one that changed the course of history. Third most significant discovery in history. Let's state it. What could it be that is that important, right? Okay. So this fundamental theorem of calculus states that derivative of this integral function, notice that there's an f up there. Okay, let's just understand what this thing is. Remember when we put b up here like before, then this is a number. It's just an area, right? But now I'm putting x here. This t is not a variable. This is what's called a dummy variable. Once you evaluate this thingy, it gives you the area, so that t disappears. You know what I'm saying? Kind of like your number two on the quiz. But once you put x up there, now this becomes a function of x. And this is a picture. This area right here is a of x right there. You get it? So x, instead of b, this thing varies. As x increases, it increases that this line moves to the right and it increases that area. You know what I'm saying? So that's the area function. Now we're going to take a derivative of it. Once you take a derivative, according to Sir Isaac, we get f of x. That's it. That is the most important theorem in history. That's remarkably simple now, isn't it? What is it saying? We have to understand what this theorem is saying. Why is it so big? The reason is, remember the shortcut? Because that's why I gave you the quiz. That how long and complex that number two is, Riemann sum integral. But we can use the antiderivative and figure out that area really quickly within few lines. What justifies such an action? What makes you think you can do such a thing other than your teacher told you so? But then just because your teacher told you does not make it true now, does it? Even if it's coming from infinitely wise, yours truly, you should still demand the proof. I rarely tell you, trust me because I told you so, okay? So here's a proof, but this theorem is going to give it to you. It's going to prove it to you. But what it's saying is this integral, which is what you did in a Riemann sum, complicated thing, and derivative cancel each other. In other words, antiderivative is the integral. Get it? There's no reason for this antiderivative convenient thing to be related to that area. Right? It's an observation. We like it to be, but whatever you really want it to be does not really mean it's always the case. Point being, the current election status, and you heard about it, and that's not really what I want it to be, but hey, it is what it is. You get it? So, now I have to prove it to you. Why integral and derivative cancels, meaning integral is the antiderivative. Okay, so here comes the proof. Okay, proof. Okay, now, first thing, I will define this a of x the way I said it. So let me move it to the right a little bit. So I will let a of x to be defined as the area function from a to x of f of t dt. You with me so far? Okay, then now I want to talk about the minimum maximum value that I talked about yesterday. Okay, let's figure out the minimum. Oh, before we even talk about that, I want to figure out what that area is. This area right here. Okay, now let's say this is H. From here to here is H. Then this point becomes X plus H, doesn't it? Okay, so somebody tell me what this area is right there, that green shaded area. Would that be A of X plus H? Would it be A of X plus H? What do you say? No, it's not.
Minus
A of X is correct, right? The way we defined it, A of X plus H is all the way from here, all the way there. You know what I'm saying? So we have to subtract that thingy. So that's this area right there, okay? Now, then we can talk about the minimum value. I'm gonna draw the minimum looking line about here. Yeah, you have to move it down a little bit, but that's okay, it's a computer. That seems to be the minimum value right here. I don't know why I am so anal, but I am. Move it a little more. Okay, now it's perfect. So we'll call this minimum of F within that H interval, correct? Okay, then we'll find the maximum value. Likewise, my maximum value will be, oh, this seems to be the maximum. I mean, if there's no reason it's the endpoint, but in this case, it turns out to be that endpoint, right? It's gotta be, there's gotta be a there. Within a closed interval, there's always minimum and a maximum, correct? Okay, now let's look at this rectangle area. Is this area of the rectangle smaller than that area function? This function thingy? Right here? Yeah, by that much and that much, correct? The green thingy got erased. It should include all the way up here. Okay, so let's state that. So up here, what is the area of this rectangle, minimum rectangle? This width times that height, which is minimum of H, correct? So I can say this is H, minimum of F. And that's less than my A of X plus H minus A of X. You with me so far? Okay, now likewise, let's look at this big rectangle. Is that area more than this area by that much right here? Of course it is, right? Okay, so that maximum area, isn't that great? These things just scroll on me when I'm recording. That's the width h times this height, which is the maximum value of our function. Max of f. Still with me? Okay. I'm going to divide everything by h. And then you're going to recognize something. So let's say we have minimum of f. I'm going to zoom in a little bit. And then we have A of X plus H minus A of X over H. And then we have max of F. Why does that thingy in the middle look so familiar? I'm going to take limit, limit, limit. Do you see the squeeze theorem bubbling up? So we take limit of H approaching zero of minimum of F less than equal to limit of h approaching zero of that thingy over h, and then limit of h approaching zero of maximum of f. Okay, somebody tell me what this thingy in the middle is. You should recognize it by now.
Difference quotient.
Difference quotient, which gives you derivative. I mean, according to our definition of derivative, right? So that is the derivative of area function that we defined. And then we have to figure out what these two things are on the side. Okay, so let's go back to the graph and figure it out. Can you imagine this thingy, this line moving and squeezing this thing? If I move this line to the left to be on top of this, because h is approaching zero, then that maximum thingy line will come down with it, correct? And then later, if I pass this point, this minimum function value will move up. And then do you see that everything will coincide exactly on one point right there? Yeah, let me draw a line. I'm gonna draw the blue line there. So whatever it is, that point will end up exactly over here now, isn't it? And what is that thingy then? What is the y value? Well, here x, this is x, so this must be f of x now, isn't it? Do you get that part? You don't get that part? You want me to bring out the animation? Let's bring out the animation. It's not exactly the same picture, but I think you'll get the point. Okay, bringing out the animation now. Okay, suppose we have a value, x value, somewhere in the middle on that. Wait, I don't need this line, so let me get rid of these lines. So suppose this is our x and f of x. This is x and f of x, right? And then this is my minimum line, and this is my maximum line, isn't it? So there has to be a maximum and minimum, and this is what we are calling h. If I bring that thingy down like this, and do you see that maximum line coming down with it? And if I bring this line, then eventually all this maximum collapses into one line right there, doesn't it? Do you get it now? So if you can animate, I mean, this little curvy, and I could have prepared a better thing, but if I bring this line right there and put it on top of this line right here, then all of this point, these two green lines will collapse into that blue line, wouldn't it? Because there's no width anymore, so everything, this point is all here, and then they all merge to this f of x. Good question. So left-hand side, the minimum and the maximum on both sides, they all become f of x. How do you like that? Okay. Well, only conclusion we can draw from this, of course, is dA dx is equal to f of x. Well, shall we remember what A was? A was our area function defined as like this, wasn't it? And that, of course, now becomes f of x, which completes the proof. This proves to you that integral is really same thing as antiderivative. And as if this is not spectacular enough, this actually gets better. What? How does it get better? Corollary, because we have this corollary. What is a corollary? It's a baby theorem, direct result of this parent theorem, mommy theorem, if you will. Not that I don't want to be gender biased or anything, but hey, mother is sacred, so it's okay, right? Okay. Can you imagine taking an antiderivative of this thing on both sides? What is the antiderivative of derivative? We just erase this derivative symbol, isn't it? So on the left-hand side, what we get is, my computer seemed to be frozen, from a to x, and then f of t dt. Good. Somebody tell me. Oh, no, not yet. And then right-hand side, for the lack of better notation, we'll just call that capital F. Good. Somebody tell me what I'm forgetting. Df, dx is f of x. This tells you that capital F is the antiderivative of our f function. You get it? Somebody tell me, what am I forgetting? I forgot something on purpose. You tell me, it's your job to point it out. I took antiderivative on both sides, and if, when you do, you should remember.
Bracket.
Oh, no, that's it. No, you're jumping the gun. We are trying to prove that. We're trying to justify that bracket antiderivative thing. Repeat?
Plus C.
Plus C, constant. You always pick up a constant. Because when you take a derivative on both sides, this goes back to that. This with this becomes little f, and this constant dies. So it could be these two are not necessarily the same thing. They could differ by any constant. You know what I'm saying? Having said that, then we have to figure out that constant. You remember initial value problem? Our initial value is when x is equal to a, isn't it? Because it starts from a. So let's substitute at x is equal to a, and then let's see what this thing gives us. So we have from a to a, f of t, dt. Somebody tell me what that value of the integral is. Now this is a number, a to
zero.
A.
Zero.
So that's zero, because there's no width of that area, right? Okay, that we covered yesterday. But on the other side, we substitute a here for x, good, plus c. Does that tell you that my c is equal to negative f of a? Doesn't it? Yeah, it does now, doesn't it? Get it? This is zero, so bring this over to the other side. Now you plug it back in here to the original equation. So we have a to x f of t dt is equal to f of x, and then instead of c, we have negative f of a. We are almost there. So next step is, I'm going to, instead of x, substitute b, because that's how we usually have the integral from a to b, right? And then this will blow your mind. So we substitute b for x, right? Look what we have. We evaluate the integral by finding an antiderivative and substitute b minus substitute a. Bang! And this is how we would like to do this integral. And this symbol, usually mathematicians put it at the end of the proof. And this was a biggie enough, so I'd like to have that. Teachers say negative area all the time, but that's like with an air quote, negative area. So when we say, mathematicians say area, that means geometrical positive only area. Okay, so let's just think about the situation. Your function changes. Remember when we are dealing with fundamental theorem of calculus, it works almost always. Right, including the pointy places like this. Just think of this as a piecewise function. You get it? So when x is less than 2, then you have x squared plus 1. When x is greater than 2, then you have 9 minus x squared. Your function changes on you. Then how do you do this? Well, easy, because you find this area. So it's this thing officially is called partitioning. You cut it and then call that a1 and calculate a1 and then rest of them separately. How about that? So let's do that much, shall we? So a1 is equal to, is from 0 to 2 now, and then x squared plus 1 dx. You with me? And find the antiderivative. So you have x cubed, therefore 1/3, plus x. Are we getting pretty comfortable with these things now? And then this is the area that we are calculus students, sadly, in high school, AP calculus students struggle the most, fraction addition. I know it's sad, right? I'll just tell you the answer, 14 over 3, because if I have you do it and wait, then I'll be waiting for next 5 minutes, and then I can't do that. Okay, go home and do it. You're already home, so do it later. Okay, then what about this part? Can we have another integral going from all the way to here, to here? No, no, no. Because this will give you positive and this will give you negative answer. You know what I'm saying? If you think of it as a particle motion, your velocity is positive, meaning going forward here and going backward here, and this integral gives you displacement. So these two cancel each other and give you, this looks slightly bigger, so the whole thing will give you slightly bigger negative, slightly negative answer. You know what I'm saying? So can't do it like that either. So what we have to do is partition this again. But hey, that's nice. So we'll call this A2 and this A3. You get it? So we have to do those separately. So A2 now is from 2 to 3 of the other function. Your function changed on you. Like that, eh? This is how you can lose a little point. This parenthesis is mandatory. If you want to be mathematically correct, not politically, but mathematically correct, this, although this, like they say, is like a grouping symbol, but if you look at any textbook, they always put parentheses here. Okay? I want you to be professional about it. I'm going to take points if you're not putting this parentheses. It's kind of like putting the equal sign as you go down, that kind of thing. You got that? Okay. Now, so this will be, and this is 9x minus, watch what I do first. I always write this first, therefore 1/3. I know you are fully capable of just coming up with 1/3 and x cubed, but that slows you down by like 10ths of a second. That's still 10ths of a second slower. So why? You're going to write both of them anyway. So I always write this exponent first, then reciprocal. Get it? And then that's from 2 to 3. And once again, since you struggle with this fraction addition, why don't I just tell you the correct answer? How about that? Good? Yeah, you will really do it without the calculator. You need to practice this. Because eventually, see, now the school will be open. Everything, pandemic will be gone, and there will be non-calculator tests. So you need to learn to do this anyway, okay? My prediction always comes true now, doesn't it?
Mr. Kim?
Yes.
In the textbook, it showed the, after you find the antiderivative, they just put a line on the right side. Is that the same thing?
Okay. Let me give you an example here. So if you have this, x squared dx, right? Let's say, oh, we had this example before, right? This one, if you do this, it's same thing as doing this, right? And some teachers actually do it like this too. This one is line. Those are equivalent. However, now with this, let's say, suppose you did this. Your textbook doesn't do this. Do you know why? There are two terms. If you do this, technically it means this thingy only applies to that thingy. You get it? So textbooks use this a lot, but they never do it when there are two terms. So that's why these kind of some notations, some books actually use this kind of notation that there's a bracket to open. And some books actually do it like that too. But whatever it is, don't do this because I'm also taking points. You know what I'm saying? I care about these grouping symbols a lot. So if you're missing it, so safer bet is always use bracket because this is nothing's wrong with this. You know what I'm saying? So I never use that notation, although I know what that means, right? So if it's used correct, then I will take it. If it's used incorrectly, I will take points. So why risk it, right? See, many times, oh, my own daughter actually asked, yeah, but is it okay if we do it this way? Why do we have to do it that way? I mean, but you could say that's correct, but is it worthwhile to risk your grade? Is it worth it? Why are kids like that, right? So yeah, take the safer way out. Okay, so let's do this. Now this one, actually I forgot to. I know the answer will be negative, eh? But area cannot be negative, so why don't I take either that or take absolute value of the whole thing? But one tiny negative sign in the front is easier to write than absolute value of the whole thing, so I'll go this way. You know what I'm saying? Because I know this will give me negative error code, negative area. Okay, let's do this then. And it's the same integrand, 9 minus x squared dx, recycling our work above. And then this, oh, forgot the limits of integration from 3 to 4a. Okay, so 3 to 4. And then that will give you now positive 10 over 3. Good. Now our total area is adding those three areas up. And then, of course, this is a little mathematician's thing. A1 plus A2 plus A3. I just want to intimidate you. And then if you add fractions correctly, you get this. You get it? Okay, how to use this area thingy antiderivative? Okay, now I want to talk about these two. According to fundamental theorem of calculus, suppose this is just x squared, right? It's not the correct answer, but then what we are supposed to get is just cosine x, right? That's what fundamental theorem tells you. See, derivative and integral cancel each other. So integral is the antiderivative. You get it? However, what's going to mess us up is then there's a square there. You right? So that can't be it now. And this is one of the favorite questions on AP. Therefore, you will see it on your test. Did I get your attention? You will see this on your test. Not this easy, but something more like this. Okay, fine. But there's a shortcut, and I'm going to teach you, but you have to understand what that shortcut is about instead of memorizing the process, because if you memorize, you know, usually bad things happen, right? This one, we can just evaluate the antiderivative, can't we? So let's do it. What's the antiderivative of cosine t? Somebody tell me.
Negative sine t.
Negative sine t, you say, right? Okay. Let's try to differentiate this to check our answer. If you differentiate negative sine t, do you get cosine t? No, you don't, right? Okay, right? It's backward, okay? You have to remember this is common, okay? So for now, while you're a newbie at this, once you find what you think is the antiderivative, you might want to quickly check in your head, if I differentiate this, do I get that back, okay? Okay, now, and then a to x squared, okay? So far, so good. Now, you're saying when I prove the fundamental theorem, this doesn't need to be zero, that a, it could be any number a, it doesn't matter. You're going to see why. Okay, now, substitute these things in. So what we have is derivative of sine x squared minus sine a. Are you good with me? Questions? Now we take the derivative right back, right? Now the chain rule will come into a play. So derivative of sine, the turkey first, Thanksgiving is approaching, so that's cosine x squared. Oh, we can have Thanksgiving, real Thanksgiving, because COVID-19, right? Or it will be cured by then. Or do we have to wait for inauguration, then it will be cured? I don't know how this technicality works. Okay. Don't go out and repeat this, okay? It was a joke. I have to say for the recording, it was a joke. These days we have to worry about these things because people don't know any sense of humor. Now, the chain rule, 2x here, good? And then this is another common mistake. Somebody tell me what's wrong with that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Huh? No. What? you're breaking up.
Do you have to do dA over dx?
Nope.
Is it just a constant?
Yeah, that's constant. A is constant. So what's the derivative of constant?
Zero.
Zero dies, right? That's why this lower limit does not matter, right? Now, let's see how we can get from here to here in one shot. For something like this on a multiple choice, you don't want to do this much work, right? What is the outside function and what is the inside function in this integral function? This entire integral is outside function and that thing is your inside function. This is your turkey and that's your duck. You get it? So you get turkey back, but then you substitute that thing in here and then you roast the duck, which is right there. You might want to just do it this way until you get comfortable with it. Okay, we'll do the second one. This one will just try to take the shortcut first. Let's predict the answer. What is your prediction? E to D? You substitute that thing in here, so negative x to the sixth power. You got that? What is your duck now? Is the duck this? The duck is this, not this. You get it? So don't be putting negative x to the fifth five, I mean, six, negative 6x to the fifth power. It's just that. So we roast the duck. So this is 3x squared. You get it? You see how to go from here to here? Doesn't matter. I'm going to do it the long way and show you why it has to be like that. See, once you do it long way, it enhances your understanding. So let's do it the long way. Okay, this now, we got stuck. Does anybody know the antiderivative of this? I sure don't. Wait, if God himself does not know it, is that the definition of non-existence? It was a joke again, God, these days. I have to laugh at these, you know what I'm saying, cancer culture. I have to laugh at them. That's the only thing you can do to these people. Okay, it's not known because they don't exist. No mathematician has ever figured that out. How's that? Let me just put it that way. Well, but we can do it this way. And what is that big F? If it exists, oh, we know actually what that is. Remember when we are proving this, right? That thingy. I don't know why I switched to red ink, but hey. So that just tells you big F is the antiderivative of that function in there. You know what I'm saying? Are we good? Now we'll just do it. So that's the derivative of, now we substitute x cubed minus, and we substitute that this is a, not zero. With me? Say yes. Okay. Now we take a derivative of this, right? What was the derivative of big F? That. Except, actually, you know what? I'm going to change this to t. I mean, it doesn't really matter, but actually, with t. E to the negative t squared, because we're going to substitute it, right? So we get e to the negative t squared, but we shove in x cubed in it. You know what I'm saying? So I'm going to bring this thing down. So what we get is this. We get e to the negative t squared, but we put x cubed in it. You know what I'm saying? And then chain rule, the duck. This is the duck. You get it? Oh, did I put negative sign? No. then you get this back. How about that? Are we good? So could we have gone from here to here directly? Yeah, sure. See, these two cancel, except this is our argument of the function. So you substitute that and get this. And then this is a chain rule applies to that inside function. Bang. How about that? Questions? Y'all with me? Okay, moving down. Okay, this is a fascinating problem. One of my favorite problems, so likely to be on your test again. Okay, let's look at this. Integral function with the sign in it. U. And this is used a lot, very popular function among electrical engineers. So we'll figure this out, okay? Do you remember what that inside thingy looks like? Okay, why don't I graph it for you? Okay, I brought this out. And X over X. Remember this thingy? And I'm gonna change. Oh, did I change the polar coordinate? No. This thingy. Do you remember it? Yeah, okay. Now, we'll sketch the derivative of this. Well, I mean, antiderivative of this. I think I messed up. I'm gonna take one more. Okay, not like that. I'm gonna take one more shot, okay? I'm gonna give myself a lot of space to graph. Okay, now I'm gonna paste it here. Whoa, that's big. Okay, now, because previously you did not know how to estimate how high these things go, right? Well, now is the time to learn how to do that, okay? Let's try to feel this. So, SI function is the integral of this, meaning the area of this, right? Or the other better way of thinking about it is, it's the antiderivative of this. You get it? Okay, so let's realize the maximum and concave up, concave down thingy, right? See, this thing is positive here, and negative here, and positive here, right? Think of this graph as the derivative of our function. Get it? Because our function is the antiderivative of this. That makes sense to you? Does that tell you this is your max, location of max right here, and this is our min? And this is max again. Say yes. Now let's think about second derivative of this. Second derivative is the derivative of this function now, isn't it? Slope of this function. It's negative from here to here, positive from here to here, negatives. In other words, point of inflection occurs right here, right? And then right here and so on at the peak. And then this is, of course, point of inflection. That makes sense to you? Okay. Now, as we graph this, and we'll graph it on top of this, so we have to be increasing and concave down all the way, right? And we are trying to guesstimate that area. So it will start here somewhere, because the reason it starts from zero, because this integral starts from zero, so that this is including initial condition. You get it? So it will start up and then concave down until somewhere here. Then still concave down, but it will start decreasing. So comes down somewhere up to here and still decreasing, but it actually changes the concavity to the other side. You know what I'm saying? Up to here until you reach the and then once you reach the minimum, still concave down, but it starts going back up. But you notice that this position and this, it went up that much, but it doesn't come down because that's a positive area and this is a negative area, so it doesn't cancel a whole lot. And then it'll be concave up until that point. And then it changes the concavity again, right? Still increasing up to about right there, and that's another maximum, and then goes the other way. You get it? You really have to practice this. What about the other side? What does the other side look like? Remember, you're going backward, right? Think about it this way. Still, this is positive and this is negative. So it's increasing concave up. This is increasing concave up, isn't it? You know what I'm saying? It's like many people draw it like that. That's decreasing function. No, don't do that. Okay, and so this will be pretty much symmetrical mirror image to the other side. You know what I'm saying? And then this is where it changes the concavity and reaches that maximum. And then change the concavity and then it goes the other side like that. Okay. I'm gonna show you the calculator version of this and then we'll compare the, I'll put it on the side. Okay, this is what I created with a calculator. This is in the Dropbox notes. You see, that thing is what I sketched here. How about that? So let's put it into that language and let's try to comprehend what it is that they want to see. So A to X, and our A is 0, so 0 to X. So these are integral functions, my favorite, definitely my favorite in calculus. Integral functions, and I already told you what my favorite means. I'm in love with these. Okay, plus some constant unknown, constant k, is equal to the other side, b to x, and b is 2 to x here, and then f of t dt is what they want us to do. However, our function, what are our functions? Well, they are sine square x, so I should have probably written those. Oh, I can still save this because it's a computer, right? So I'm gonna shove it out of the way like that and then erase these guys and erase that. And then I'm gonna rewrite it. So this is a sine squared x. Sine squared t then, eh? You see why it has to be t? Because we are changing our variable to dummy variable t, because our real variable is x, and x is up here. You know what I'm saying? So this is our problem. And then you get stuck right here, because you don't know how to find the antiderivative of sine squared, eh? Yeah, that's our problem now. So this, when you're doing identity, I'm not sure if you remember, but I said there's a most critical important one, and that will be on 5 different tests at least. Yeah, it's that one. Let's start right here on the side. Cosine. Cosine 2x. What was that? It's got 3 different forms, but I want the one that has a sine square in it. And after taking that identity test, we all know this is 1 minus 2 sine squared x, say. You know what I'm saying? So let's use t. We are using t. So, I mean, we are so used to x, but let's use t. So 2t is equal to sine squared t. So therefore, sine squared t is equal to 1 minus cosine 2t all divided by 2a. Yeah, you kind of need that. So let's shove it in, right? But, while I shove it in, why don't I just solve for this k? Because it's k that we want after all, right? Yeah, so let's do that. So k is equal to integral of from 2 to x, and then sine squared t is now 1 minus cosine 2t over 2, right? 1 minus cosine 2t over 2 dt minus the other integral, which is 0 to x of same thing, 1 minus cosine 2t over 2 dt. Too much algebra? Too much algebra calculus combo? Or you got this? Okay, and can we combine these integrals? No, you can. What am I saying? Okay. Can we, actually we can combine these integrals too, right? Do you see how?
Do you make the second one positive? Like you take out a negative?
Yeah, see if I switch, 0 to x and then x to 2, you know what I'm saying? So I'm gonna switch this as well. Wait. And you don't have to do it this way, you can just evaluate both of them, but this is a clever trick. Oh, I never told you that plumbing professors told me. Now, when I do this, can I take out half into the front? No, I'll do it later. I don't want to confuse you. So 1 minus cosine 2t over 2 dt minus, and then here is 0 to x. And then 1 minus cosine 2t over 2 dt. You with me? Now, this is, let's say this x does not have to be between 0 and 2, but let's just, to make our picture go smoothly, think about it this way. Cosine function, 1 minus cosine function, let's say like looks like this, right? So this is 0, and let's say 2 is somewhere here, and this is x. You see, integrals, oh, my just dropped. Hold on. How does that fall out? And I caught it with my thighs. Isn't that amazing reflex or what? And all of this is being recorded live. Oh my God, this has got to be some video now, right? Sometimes I amaze myself. Microphone is falling between my thighs and I just caught him with my thighs. That was close. Okay. See, integrals do add 0 to x and x to 2, right? And this is still true even x is out there. You get the idea? Let's combine it. So when we combine it, then all this denominator 2, right? I'm going to take common factor it. So I'm going to take negative 1 half out. Then this will be from 0 to 2. You know what I'm saying? That's a clever. You don't have to do it this way. You can evaluate this, you can evaluate this. But then I like to combine stuff and recycle my work. So then we have here now 1 minus cosine 2t dt. Huh. X has disappeared. Because otherwise you're solving this trig equation. You know what I'm saying? So I thought this was a really, really clever trick. Triumphant of algebra. I know, huh? I sometimes amaze myself too. Okay. Shall we find the antiderivatives now? Yeah, let's do that. So 1 becomes t. Somebody tell me what the antiderivative of cosine 2t is. This is how you do it. Sine 2t, you just write this down first, and then you take a derivative, and then like backward chain rule kind of thing. So if I take a derivative, sine becomes cosine, so this negative sign stays. Otherwise, if I get negative something, then I have to change this to positive. And then chain rule, this 2 comes out to the front. Well, I don't see 2 here, so I have to compensate for that. You get it? Let's check one more time. Derivative of sine, cosine, minus sine stays, and that 2 comes out and cancel this 1 half. K Can you think like this? From 0 to 2. Now, here comes the reason why I wanted to combine it like that and not really have in terms of x and solve. You will see. So this is negative 1/2 of substitute 2, right? Minus 1/2 of sine 4. And then once you substitute 0, it becomes 0. This thing becomes 0. So this is it. You know what I'm saying? What the hell is sine 4? Well, this is a calculator problem. So I did not want to solve this kind of thing in terms of x. You get it? You want to make it look prettier by distributing? Yeah, let's do that. So we have 1/4 sine 4 and then minus 1. How about that? Okay, so this is some kind of negative number. You got it? Aren't integral functions great? Oh, in applied mathematics, you have no idea how big integral functions are. And then people write computer programs on it. Okay, let's go to 57, my favorite. Told you this is my favorite type. Not only that this has integral function, but it asks you all these nice questions too, right? Oh my God, this is just too good. Definitely test worthy, okay? H is, let me write down the equivalence statement right here. H of x is this integral function with f in it. That means h prime of x, a derivative of h is equal to f of x. Do you see that relationship? If we take a derivative on both sides, fundamental theorem tells you integral and derivative cancels. You get it? So now we have had this kind of problem before, right? Oh yeah. Now we can do it, answer all of these questions, and I'm going to go through all of it because probably I'm going to put something like this on the test. So h of 0, a. H of 0, it just means this. H, remember, is this integral, so from 0 to 0 of f of t dt. Huh, that's got to be 0 now, eh? Right, integral, it has no width on this area from here to here. You get it? On what interval h is increasing, and explain. You remember my format? It still has to be this way. So b, I'm going to put b here, b, h, we forget that increasing thingy, and then we say h of x, h prime of x is positive, meaning it happens to be increasing on, and then we look at it, oh, this is positive right there, and this is negative right there now, isn't it? And it has to be in this format only, otherwise this portion is automatic zero. You've been warned. And this is officially under recording, is automatic zero unless it's written in this very form. Don't tell me the h prime changed the sign or anything like that. So where is it positive? Well, from 0 to 6. And that tells you the answer and the justification as well. You get it? Answer and the justification. Bang. You get it? Okay, C. On what interval is the graph concave up? Well, concavity has to do with h double prime. You know what I'm saying? H double prime of x, of course, is f prime of x, isn't it? Where h prime was f of x, so we are looking at this. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to make another notation here in case it was not clear. This is h prime of x, right? So f double prime, well, h double prime is f prime, right? F prime, and now this means concave up, so this needs to be positive, right? That means concave up on, now let's see, f prime is the slope of this thing. Slope needs to be positive, so from here to there, you know what I'm saying? It's concave up. What does it look like about there? Is it about, is it 9-ish?
Nine.
Let's say that's 9. So 9 and 12. And then notice that I'm just using parentheses exclusively. Because otherwise you have to worry about bracket here and yeah, so it's like that's not good. Okay, any questions so far before I go to D? Is H12 positive or negative? D. D here. H12, let's just look at it. H12 is this area minus this area, isn't it? Okay, so let's write it like that. So H12, I'm gonna do D down here. D. It's not one to write. D. H12 means your integral from 0 to 12 of f of t dt. Good. Now that we can think of it as we can chop it up from 0 to 6 up here. 0 to 6 of f of t dt. And plus 6 to 12. Okay. Now, which area is bigger? I'm going to erase these plus and minus signs. Let's call this thing area 1 and this thing area 2. Do you see that A1 is bigger than A2? Which means it's got to be positive now, right? So we can say this is positive. This is positive. We can say A1 is greater than A2, but how do you want to say that professionally? And you don't have to say it this professionally, but I'm a mathematician, so I have to, right? This is greater because, watch this. Absolute value of 0 to 6 f of t dt is greater by looking at it than this area, 6 to 12 of f of t. Do you understand it? And then I'm going to put little, what that means is A1 is greater than A2. You get it? By looking at it, it's got to be greater, right? This thing is bigger than this. So if you integrate it, this gives you positive, this gives you negative, but positive is bigger, is all I'm saying. I know mathematicians have a way of putting some things that this plane and then put it into this kind of format. Yeah, on behalf of all mathematicians, I offer my sincere apologies. Okay, now E. But when does H achieve maximum? Okay, H will achieve maximum right there at 6, correct? Right, so E. Let's just say this all over again. H prime of X, which is F of X, positive on 0 to 6. And h prime of x, which is f of x, negative on 6 to 12, right? Therefore, maximum is h of 6. You get it? Okay, it has to be in this form, okay? Maybe it's okay to not put parentheses increasing, decreasing part, but this tells you clearly increasing to decreasing. Okay, now F, this is the one she's been, Sarah, has been patiently waiting. Minimum value. Ooh, where is it minimum? Where's minimum? Isn't there no minimum? Because there's no, endpoint. Endpoint comes into play. Because this is not it. So our endpoint is either 0 or 12. So which is bigger? You know what I'm saying? Okay, let's go back. From A, H of 0 is 0. Good. From D, H of 12 is some positive number. Which is smaller of the two? 0, of course, right? Ah, there's your answer. So pushing this thing down a little bit. So F, H of 0 is the minimum. Since H of 0 is equal to 0, you see, how do you like my complete sentences? This is what complete sentence looks like in math. And H of 12 is positive, which is means not zero. You know what I'm saying? So H of 0 is the minimum. You get it? That's the lowest point you can ever get. Wow, such a beauty. How do you not love some problem like this? You know I do. On your test. Okay, question. I saw a hand.
For D, what do you want us to show?
This, what I have. This is the explanation. When it says explain, I definitely don't want to see your paragraph. I'm not reading it. Especially if it is so tiny and you can jam in so much information into that tiny space, I'm definitely not reading it with these old eyes, okay? Okay, this is what explanation is. This is justification. These are complete sentences. You get it? Okay. Now, then, shall we go? Any other question before we go to number 61? Linearization of integral function, which is also beauty. Okay, let's go to this linearization then. You know, linearization is just the equation of the tangent line, isn't it? So we need a point and a slope, eh? Okay, let's find the point. So linearization of this at 0, so we need point. What is this? Well, this is same as 2 plus integral from 0 to 0 of 10 over 1 plus t dt, a. And that integral gives you 0, so that's 2, a. Say yes. Okay, then f prime of x, let's find the derivative. I mean, it's the exact same process. So the 2 dies, and then what's the derivative of that integral? This thing here, of course, right? And then you drop x in here, right? Oh, amazing, huh? So, well then, we can evaluate this at 0. And once you plug in 0, does that give you 10? Now, point slope formula. So we can do y minus y1, L of x, which is y, but we just use a fancy name, minus your point 2 is equal to slope 10 times x minus 0, a. So therefore, L of x is equal to 10x plus 2. How do you like it? Is that good? Don't you love it? It's the exact same thing. It's just our function looks like this. But that is even more beautiful than before. So how can you not love it? What is there not to love?